Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. In our last segment, we walked through the lower cost or market logic. We talked about estimating ending inventory and why that was important and how we could use it, and just the importance of inventory again in general. Things we've talked about in the past or you should have learned about in the past, but now it's time to refresh and talk about them again. We ended up our discussion talking about the steps to doing the lower of cost or market calculation. They looked like this. Now that we've gone through these steps, it's time to actually use them. Journal entries. Yes, I'm so excited. So let's take a look at an example of this lower of cost or market adjustment. Jones Company is worried that some of their inventory is obsolete. So that takes care of step one. We think that we've got some obsolete inventory. And remember, that was that key step. If you don't believe that, then nothing else matters. Using the chart below, and I'm going to bring that up right now, we want to make the necessary journal entry, if any, for Jones to account for the drop in inventory value under both the direct and the allowance methods. Remember, this allowance method is what FASB prefers, but most companies choose to use this direct method. So for the purposes of learning, we'll go ahead and make sure we've got them both, but just be aware that chances are what you'll see the most will be this direct method. Here's our information. I'll give you a second to find that in your PowerPoint file or jot some of those numbers down so you don't have to flip back and forth. And then let's go ahead and start doing some calculations. Now I'm going to start with a table. And I'm going to put the item over here. And then I'm going to calculate the historical cost, or I guess I'm not really calculating it, I'll just jot it down. We need the current sales price. And then any, we're going to call them disposal costs. And please note that these won't always be labeled as disposal costs, but these are anything and everything we have to spend in order to actually make this sale. So if there's been a fire, I think things have dropped because they were, you know, soaked with the water from the fire department or smoke damage or whatever. My disposal costs may be cleaning things up. If I just can't sell them at this store, but maybe if I could get them downtown, I could sell them there, then the disposal cost would be the transfer. Could be that I need to put a monogram on them for the people buying the, or you know, making the order. Fine, we'll put that in there. It's anything and everything we have to spend to get them ready to sell. Once I've got my sales price and my disposal cost, then I can calculate my net realizable value. And finally, I'll have a lower of cost or market column as well. So let's start with item A, and then we'll give you a few minutes and let you do the calculations on your own for the other three items. So the historical cost that I have on my books right now for item A is $110. My current sales price is $125. And if I were to stop right there, I think I was fine. I mean, I paid $110 for them. I can sell them for $125. I can still make a profit here. I shouldn't have a problem. But if you look at the table, it'll cost me $30 to get these ready to sell. So if I take the $125 and subtract the $30, my net realizable value, or what I think I can get from these items, is only $95 a piece. And if I compare that with the $110, I need to do a write down. And my lower of cost or market, I should label this better, my adjustment, lower of cost or market adjustment, is going to be $15. That's the $110 minus the $95. Now, I'll put in the other items here, B, C, and D. Before going on with the video, take a minute and do the rest of the calculations yourself. Let's go ahead and pick back up with our discussion. Hopefully you came up with a table that looks something like this. There's our historical cost, current sales price, disposal cost, and net realizable value for each of our other three items. If we compare historical cost to net realizable value for item B, I need another $10 adjustment. For item C, I don't have to adjust at all. For item D, it looks like I need to write everything down by $5. Now that I know the adjustment amounts, I can figure out the amount of my journal entry. So let's do another little table, or if you've got space, you can put it off to the side. We'll put down the number of units and then the lower of cost or market adjustment And you'll also see this called our write-down. So let's see, our write-down was 15 Friday, May, $10, nothing, and then $5. And our units were given to us, 100 units of A, we've got 150 of B. I don't even care about C, because I don't have any adjustment that I need to make. And then 50 units of item D, and that allows me to get my total by just multiplying. So 100 times 15 is a $1,500 adjustment. Another $1,500 adjustment. No adjustment here. And down at the bottom, a very small $250 adjustment. If I add all that up, my total adjustment will be $3,250. On to the best part of this, and that's the journal entry. And I'm going to break this into two pieces. Let's do the direct method on the left, and we'll do the allowance method over here on the right. Starting with the direct method, I know the amount, it was $3,250. Under the direct method, as an adjusting entry for year, well, we'll just say year four, just so we've got a year here. Cost of goods sold would get debited by the $3,250, and inventory would decrease for the same amount. And of course, I always have a description, so this is an adjusting entry for lower of cost or market adjustment, and then I would put a reference to wherever my calculations were so that I know how I calculated that $3,250. For the allowance method, same exact number, the only difference, see 12, 31, and again, we just randomly chose that year four, so we'd have a number. This is a loss due to market decline of inventory. Say that five times fast. $3,250. And I'll have an allowance for market decline of inventory. And I'll squeeze that in here, hopefully making it look offset. Oh, made it. Again, this is an adjusting entry for a lower of cost or market adjustment or write down. Now, hopefully that makes sense. I've got my journal entries, I've got the calculation, I've dropped the value. The other piece we need to talk about though is, well, what happens next year? Let's say somebody comes into our shop and buys just one item of B after we do this write down. Well, what will our journal entries look like under the two methods if we have this person buy one of these less valuable units that we've written down? So let's take a look at that. Split this off here. This will be, oh, let's say it was February 23rd now of year five. So it's the year after we've made the adjustment. Well, if you remember, our cash amount, our sales price for this item was $160. That was our best guess on what we thought we could sell it for. So I'll record cash and sales revenue of $160. The next thing I would need to record would be cost of goods sold, and then I'd need to get rid of my inventory. Now, we wrote this item down in inventory to $140, right? That was what we dropped it to. In addition, now before we're done here, remember there's a disposal cost. It's gonna cost us $20. This is, again, the cleanup cost or to get it shipped to the right place or whatever it is we have to spend to get it ready to sell. And notice that these numbers match. My sales revenue and my cost of goods sold match up now. That was the point of a lower of cost or market write-down. I wrote it down to its market value. The revenue and the cost are now the same. That's the point. And I would make a note, this is to sell one unit of item B. And if I wanted to, I could refer back to that adjusting entry last year. Under the allowance method, same basis up here. My revenue and my cash stay the same. What changes is this second entry. Again, I've got cost of goods sold I'm going to record. I'm going to record my inventory. But in this case, I didn't write the inventory down. I used an allowance account instead. So my inventory is still at 150, and I have an allowance for market decline, dot, dot, dot. I'm not going to put all the rest of that in there. But my allowance was $10 per unit for B. Was 150, wrote it down to 140. And the net of these two, that gives me the $140. Again, I'm paying cash for those disposal costs. And I end up with cost of goods sold to make this balance. Let's see, 150 plus 20 minus 10. There's that 160 again. So you'll notice a couple of important things here. Whoops, before we do that, don't leave it naked, Jason. First, as we've already discussed, there's no profit on these items because I wrote them down to what I thought I was going to get out of them. And unless I can sell them for more than my guess, then there's no profit anymore. I wrote them down just low enough that my profit and my cost would equal out. That was the goal. I can still show an extra loss here. If the disposal costs go up, I could show maybe a bit of a gain or some profit. It wouldn't be a gain, it would just be revenue above cost of goods sold. If that disposal cost is less, or if I can sell it for a little more than I thought. The other thing that's really important between the two methods, notice that the net revenue amount is the same and the cost of goods sold ends up exactly the same. So the only thing you're really getting that is beneficial, and FASB really likes this again, is we have that allowance on our books. We show it as a loss originally, so it's a little more informative to our investors. But the net effect is going to come out to be exactly the same between the two. Now, just be aware there are some problems with lower of cost or market. First off, we recognize drops in value, but we don't recognize increases, so we're lopsided. Now, accounting for a long time has been conservative. That's how we identify as accountants. We're going to be conservative in what we do. But we're moving towards neutrality, and this is not neutral. This is conservative still. We're writing down, but not back up. In addition, it leads to inconsistent numbers between years. Last year, in year three, I recorded this as being worth $150. Now I'm recording it as $140, and moving forward, I may have to write it down again. So my numbers aren't comparable anymore on my balance sheet because I've written this down. The third issue here is the conservatism. Part of the conservatism is that it's lopsided. We go down but not up. But the other part of conservatism is if I do a big write down now, later on in the future, I can show a large increase. Because if I say, oh, you know what, I think those units are only worth $100. I'm having a bad year anyway. I'll drop my inventory value all the way down from 150 for that item B down to 100. Brings down my net income. Everything looks horrible that year, but when I sell it, I can sell it for $160. Even with that $20 disposal cost, I can show a $40 profit, extra profit on these items. So this is one of the big issues with this lower cost or market method, is that I can conceivably create some earnings manipulations or some extra profit in the future by playing around with the numbers. And that's what that last point is about too, is I'm using estimates, and as the manager, I can play around with estimates. This process used to be a lot longer. FASB just simplified it just a little while ago. It was this three-step process that we're trying to use to keep people from manipulating numbers, and FASB ultimately decided that the benefit wasn't big enough to offset the cost. So because of that, they've eliminated these extra steps and just brought it back to being this one simple calculation. And because of that, we're really very consistent with IFRS now. So IFRS requires companies to assess inventory periodically. We don't have to have a reason to believe it. We're just supposed to check every once in a while, make sure our inventory hasn't dropped in value. The other major change that remains between IFRS and US GAAP is the fact that we can write inventory back up under IFRS. So if item B all of a sudden becomes hot again, people decide they want to collect records and they need stereos that allow them to play records, all of my inventory jumps up in value, I can write it back up. I can go, let's see, our item B was originally 150, I wrote it down to 140, I can write it back up to 150. Can't go higher, but I can at least write it back up to that original historical cost. Before we wrap this up, let's take a look at one last example. This is an international company, Sanchez Co. They have a law of cost or market issue that they think they need to deal with. This time, I've given you the numbers a little bit differently. In the example we just did, I gave you individual items and then we multiplied by the number of units to get to a total at the end. This time, I've given you totals so that you can do it what is, for some companies, a more common way. And I've given you not just one set of numbers, but two. Before you move on to the next segment, please take a few minutes, do these two separate examples, the 2A column, 2B column, so you can see a couple of options and how things change. Do those calculations, and when we come back, we'll review them briefly before we move on to our discussion of ending inventory. We'll see you then.